Thank you. Well, good evening and welcome to church this evening. If you're visiting with us or you're back seeing us, it's good to see you this evening. As we prepare our hearts for worship this evening, we're going to be looking at Song of Solomon again later in the service. Here's a little section from Isaiah 61 that picks up some of the themes that we've been discovering in the song. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me in the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decks himself like a priest with a beautiful headdress, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels, for as the earth brings forth its sprouts, and as a garden causes what is sown to sprout up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to sprout up before all the nations. Our great God, we come to you this evening to thank you that you invite us, your people, indeed you call us as your people, to join with you, to come before you, to approach your throne, and come as we are to find your mercy, to find your grace, to help us in our time of need, to find the eyes of our understanding opened in order that we might grasp and adore the mysteries of who you are. Might come, whatever our condition or state, to find that you are the great physician and that you will heal us of all of our needs as we bring them to you this evening and give us eternal life, that life that we need. We come, Lord, needy to you. We come adoring you. We come marveling at your love and pray that you would draw near to us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Please remain standing, and we will pray together the prayer of confession found in your bulletin. Let's pray. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own heart. We have left undone those things which we ought not to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us. And grant, O merciful Father, for Jesus' sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and joyful life to the glory of your name. Amen. Now hear the gospel's pardon for all those who trust in Christ. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are a people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy.
Scripture reading tonight is from Song of Solomon, chapter 1, right at the end of it. That can be found on page 560 if you're using the church Bible. It is a joy going through this special book. As you have finished turning there, let us unite our hearts together in prayer and ask God for his blessing on our time. Dear Heavenly Father, we have come at your beckon. We have come because you have called us. You have called us by righteousness, and you have called us by your word. As we come, it is our desire to hear you speak to us. And so we pray that you would not only open the Bible, but you would give us of your spirit, that we might be lifted up before your throne of grace to understand, to be taught, to be inspired. But most of all, Lord, that we may hear of love, love divine, all loves excelling. This morning we heard of faith, and we know the triad of faith, hope, and love, but we know that the greatest is love. So we come with hearts that are full and expectant and ask that indeed you will teach us, you will draw us, you will lead us in worship now. For it is in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. So we begin reading chapter 1 at verse 15. Behold, you are beautiful, my love. Behold, you are beautiful. Your eyes are doves. Behold, you are beautiful, my beloved, truly delightful. Our couch is green. The beams of our house are cedar. Our rafters are pine. I am a rose of Sharon, a lily of the valleys.
Thank you.
pray. Father, we praise you for the love that you have shown to us in Christ. And we praise you, O Christ, for the vast love that you showed to us in becoming man and dying on a cross for our sins. And we thank you, Spirit, for opening our eyes to the greatness of this love. We pray we would abide in it more. And we pray, just as we have just sang, that you would give us a growing love, particularly now, that a love that would result in an abounding generosity. We pray for these offerings, that you will use them so that your gospel might go forth and more love to you might result from the nations, from those in Philadelphia and throughout the world. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Oh,
Bibles and we'll look together at Song of Songs and those verses we read earlier. For those who are coming in on our study of this book, we are working on the assumption that all Scripture is inspired by God and has as its focus and purpose the Lord Jesus Christ, who preached from all the Scriptures the things concerning Himself. And we're taking as our starting point the song, the description of the song that's given right at the very beginning. This is the Song of Songs, in which we enter the Holy of Holies and find the King of Kings. And so as we've been looking at this so far, we've been considering the bride and the bridegroom as representing Christ and the church. And in the passage we're looking at this evening, we have Christ urging us to consider the church. Behold, he says, I want you to look, to focus. And before we go any further, it's perhaps helpful for us at this point to pause for a moment and consider why it is that in this book, the description of Christ and the church, the bridegroom and the bride, is so important for us to grasp. Paul tells us that it was to teach us a deep mystery, that marriage was invented, the relationship between the bridegroom and the bride was invented, not to give us an illustration, but in fact was invented particularly to point us to the deeper mystery concerning Christ and the church. From the very beginning of the Bible, the story is driven by the promise of God to Eve of a son who would come, who would defeat the enemy of man and God. This promise of the seed of the woman is expanded in Scripture. The line we draw is from that promise of the seed to Eve, to the seed of Abraham, to the scepter that will come out of Judah, to the seed of David, to the virgin's son, and to the arrival of the Savior himself. This is the Song of Songs. In the Bible, the Song of Songs is the greatest song. It is the superlative song. That song is not about human love. It is about the love of Christ for his church. It is, this song outshines the songs of salvation we find in the Bible, because it is the song of the love of God in Christ for his people. The one who would come born of a woman at the right time, when the fullness of time had come, to redeem and to adopt us as his family. And it's the adopted and redeemed that are set forth in this psalm, in this song, as the royal bride of the King of Kings. God sent forth his son. From heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. It's this action alone that makes her, his bride, attractive, as we shall see. And she's recognized this. In verse 12, we noticed a more accurate translation. While the king was on his couch, my nard, my spikenard, gave forth his fragrance. And we saw the connections here between that risk reference and the references we find in the New Testament in relation to Christ and his fragrance. Christ would have us consider his bride. Christ would have us admire his bride. Now he's speaking to her. Behold, he says, you are beautiful, my love. Christ considers his people, his church, a beautiful church, not on account of her good works, not because of any inherent righteousness on her part. In fact, her righteousness is but filthy rags, an unclean thing. The beauty of the church rests in her relationship, it rests in the fact that anything good in her comes from him, verse 12. The bridegroom draws attention to this. Behold, he says. Earlier on, back in verse 5, she's been preoccupied with her defects, sunburned and rough-looking on the outside, because she's been following the ways of the world, neglecting her own duties. Sometimes a sensitive believer is so taken up with their past and with their failures and with their sins and with their imperfections that they don't see and understand how Christ sees them. Behold, you are beautiful, Christ says. Jesus, your blood and righteousness, my beauty is, my glorious dress, midst flaming worlds, with these arrayed, with joy shall I lift up my head. As he says, behold, he wants the church to know what he thinks of his church. He wants his church to see the beauty that he has placed upon her. She is doubly beautiful. Behold, you are beautiful, he says to his bride. My beloved, behold, you are beautiful. Doubly beautiful. Believers are often apt to question their completeness in Christ. By nature, we are children of wrath. As such, we are dead in our trespasses and sins. Even now in Christ, we're tossed about by the world around us, making demands upon us, trying to fit us into their mold. We buy into its lies, we adopt its values, we mouth its profanities. In fact, if you go back to verse 5, you find she complains in verse 6, it was her mother's sons, it was her relatives, it's the people she's related to who sucked her away from Christ, who drew her away from her duties, who drew her away from her obligations to the law of God. It was her relatives, her fellow human beings, it was members of her own family who drew her away, those to whom she was naturally related, drew her into sin and away from Christ. And that's the way it is with all of us. By nature, we're part of the mass of humanity in rebellion against God, easily drawn away from Christ. And Christ speaks to restore his church's sense of who she is, to remove her doubts, to banish her unbelief, to strengthen her faith. She is doubly beautiful to him. He created her. He redeemed her. The most beautiful among women, he says in verse 8. There is no one to compare with her, nothing to compare with her. She is what she is by his grace. Christ wants the church to know what he thinks of her. Christ wants the world to know what he thinks of her. He rejoices in her. She is his love. Do you notice that? You are beautiful, my love, my close one, literally. Do you know these words from Isaiah 62? As the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. That God delights to say in Christ to his church, my love, the object of my love, from all eternity, the object of my love. He has set his love upon us. He has chosen us. He has come into the world to act for us. It's as if the Lord looks you in the eye this evening and he says to you, you, my child, are my love. You, my church, are my love. Never forget that. The object of my love. In the New Testament, we read about the good work that he has begun in us by engrafting us into Christ. And as we become more and more one with him, our beauty increases by his beauty becoming ours. We are made one with Christ by union with him. We are in Christ. That union is invisible to our eyes and to the world's eyes, but it's real. We're justified and we're declared righteous in his eyes because we're clothed with his righteousness. But the world doesn't see that. The work of sanctification has begun, by which increasingly the excellencies of Christ are cultivated by the Spirit in us. Our beauty, the church's beauty, is inseparable from its holiness. You are beautiful, my close one. Gregory of Nyssa teaches us that by these expressions, the Word, that is Christ, teaches that the restoration of the soul's beauty consists in her drawing near once again to the true beauty, that is Christ, from which she has departed. Behold, you are beautiful, my close one. Which is to say, the reason why you were not beautiful before you knew me, is that you'd been estranged from the archetypal beauty that is Christ and have become ugly because of your wrongful association with evil. Human nature, unlike divine nature, human nature is mutable. That is, it is capable of change. When we follow the passion of anger or cowardice or fear, we become angry, cowardly, or fearful. But when we draw near to Christ, when we are indwelt by his Holy Spirit, the believer over time begins to show the character of Christ. We begin to mirror him. We mirror his love by becoming loving. We mirror his peace by being peaceable, his gentleness by being gentle, his meekness by being meek, his humility by being humble. We become beautiful by staying close to him, by being his close one, by participating in the beauty that is Christ. We make it our own. You are beautiful, my close one. And as believers, we're beautiful absolutely to Jesus. Origen, one of the fathers, thought the repetition here pointed to a still deeper mystery that is indicated that the bride of Christ will be beautiful not just in this present age, but also in the age to come. Bernard of Clairvaux, one of the great commentators on the Song of Solomon, asks, in what way do we hear these words of Christ coming to us, telling us what he thinks of us? How does, he asks, how do the words that are spoken by the Word, Christ, speak to the soul? How do we hear his voice? The voice of the King, the bridegroom. And he warns us in his sermon, he warns us against thinking that there is an audible voice that you will hear. You're off your head if you hear one, other than mine in the service tonight, okay? No, it doesn't come in audible signs. It is the Holy Spirit who speaks through the word he has given, and it's only the spiritual, only the bride understands, recognizes the voice of the bridegroom. Paul puts it like this, no one comprehends the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. Now we have received the Spirit who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given to us by God. And we impart this in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. You have to belong to Christ to recognize Christ. You have to know him to know his voice, which is why Paul prays for us that the eyes of our understanding would be enlightened, that we would know, that we would know. And it's with this in mind then that the bridegroom draws attention to the eyes of his beloved bride. You are beautiful. Your eyes are doves. And there's an intentional poetic parallel with my love or my close one. There's a relationship between these two. Now, the eyes are the vehicle through which we see the world that God has made. We can have an evil eye. We can have an eye full of adultery. We can have a haughty eye. But what does it mean, I wonder, to have eyes like doves? How can we know that the mind of Christ will interpret spiritually the message from the bridegroom? Now I repeat, this is Christ speaking to the church. Behold, you can see it. It is spiritually discerned. Your eyes are doves. Remember the baptism of Jesus? There was a manifestation of God as Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The manifestation came like this. There was a manifestation of the Father because a voice was heard, a created voice through which the Father speaks. There's a manifestation of the eternal Son in the person of Christ who is being baptized, in the man Christ Jesus. And there's a manifestation of the Spirit because the Spirit creates a dove and is represented by the dove. Now, what we're being taught here is that the eyes of our understanding had been enlightened. Just earlier in this song in verse 12, she has confessed that he is the King. And no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. And she will go on to say, behold, you are beautiful, my beloved, truly delightful. And you can't say that unless you know Jesus by the Holy Spirit. Gregory of Nyssa says that people receive in themselves the likeness of what they gaze at intently. So if under the working of the Holy Spirit we look less at flesh and blood and more at spiritual things, if we live in the Spirit, if we walk in the Spirit, we will put to death the things of the flesh and we will become more like Christ, harmless as doves. Thirdly, Christ would have us listen to his bride. Whatever is commendable in the believer should ultimately resolve upon Christ, says Durham, an old commentator. Here she is. Behold, you are beautiful. She says, No, I don't want to hear that. I mean, I love to hear it. But no, you're the beautiful one. You're the one. I'm only beautiful because I've been touched by beauty in its ultimate sense, in its quintessential sense, by the origin of beauty. I've been touched by this. That's why I'm beauty. In other words, she speaks as one who has the eyes of the dove. She sees what the Holy Spirit sees in Jesus. Now she has eyes for nothing less, not for human approval, not for glory, not for celebrity, not for worldly power. Gregory puts it like this, that which is honored in this world, after all, has its being only in the heads of people who make the judgment. But when the church addresses the bridegroom, she says, you are truly beautiful. You are beauty. All uppercase letters. The very essence of beauty, existing forever as such, being at every moment what you are, neither blooming when the appropriate time comes or putting off your bloom at the right time, but stretching your springtime splendor out to match the everlastingness of your life, you whose name is love. So the church names him. Do you see? You are beautiful. My beloved, the church names him, beloved. because we are accepted in the Beloved. He was the one named by the Father, the Beloved Son. Behold my Beloved. Do you see a parallel here? Behold, you are beautiful, my Beloved. Behold my Beloved Son. The church says with the psalmist, I love you, Lord, and confesses with Peter, Lord, you know all things, you know that I love you. And she finds him utterly delightful. For a little glimpse of Jesus' worth has such an attractive power over us, draws out from within us all our affections directed towards him. And she speaks of him. Our resting place is green. The NIV has verdant, means the same thing. It's a picture of a garden, a kind of little break among the trees, a place where you can sit down, put out your rug, rest, stop. She's had this in mind because she's been working hard and she's been looking for a place where her beloved rests his sheep. She wants to be with them when the flocks rest and find a place where they can rest and be fed and drink water and so on. She's used that imagery already here in chapter 1. This imagery is at the back of this picture here. Here's a little oasis of peace, refreshment, recovery, where the couple, the Christ and his church, the bridegroom and the bride, can reconnect and enjoy communion. Our heavenly bridegroom has mingled with the human race, bringing the divine and human into union, perfect union. And in the days of his flesh, the radiance of deity was hidden in that body. Here is mortal and immortal, perishable and imperishable, accessible and inaccessible, joined, united for us and for our salvation. And that union finds expression in those points where the church and Christ meet together. Here's how it's put in Psalm 132. For the Lord has chosen Zion. Zion is often a description of the church, usually feminine. He has desired it for his dwelling place. This is my resting place forever. Here I will dwell, for I have desired it. It's a strong word, desired it. I will abundantly bless her provisions. I will satisfy her poor with bread. Her priests I will clothe with salvation, and her saints will shout for joy. Christ longs to have this place where he and his bride meet together. A place of grace, means of grace, where Christ and the bride share, where he shares his possessions with his bride. Now, this communion could never have taken place had the Lord not taken our human nature to manifest himself. In this first chapter, we've discovered already that the bride, beloved, was a king and a shepherd. Both of those ideas have been intertwined in what we've looked at up to this point. And that's important background to understand what we are to consider when we talk about this resting place being green or verdant. The Lord is my shepherd. The king and the shepherd are one. The Lord is my shepherd. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. That's a triple clue. I am is the name for Yahweh. Good, only God is good. The shepherd, the Lord, is my shepherd. And as the shepherd, he causes his people to lay down in green pastures, so that he might restore them, so that he might refresh them. You will find rest for your soul. I will give you rest. He calls his people together. He calls his people to rest for a while with him. He's there. They're there. They're together. As we come Sunday by Sunday to public worship as God's covenant people, what are we doing? We're coming to rest a while, to find a place where, as it were, we can stop and stay and enjoy communion, the church, with the church's Lord. For a time, we can get away from all of those distractions that are constantly pulling at our imagination, trying to get our affections directed elsewhere, and for a time to stop and consider the Lord, to reflect on him. We're such busy bees. We're so often doers. And we need to be poets. We need to pause. We need to use our sanctified imagination. We need to reflect on the one who loves us. He loved us. We only love him back. Because he means to build a temple. Our house, the beams of the house are cedar, and the rafters are pine. Those are elements of the temple that Solomon built. He means to turn our resting place into a temple. We are the stones in the temple. We are being built into a temple. When the bride, on the great wedding day that's coming by and by, comes down from heaven as New Jerusalem and is united finally with her husband, with her bridegroom, with Christ, it will be a garden temple. A garden temple. Both of those elements, as it were, morphed into one. No need of a temple there, for God and the Lamb are in it. And his people enjoying him forever, forever. Christ wants you to listen to the church as she talks to her Savior, because she knows that she's been loved. And she loves him. Let's pray. Father, we pray that you would take these beautiful poetic pictures in this Song of Songs, and that you would be pleased to reach down into parts of our imagination, parts of our soul that we don't normally reach, and release from inside of us affections and longings and enjoyment and appreciation for our Lord, our dear Lord, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.